You out this meeting.
I don't
Do
have
you?
any, I don't have any applications to present to you guys today. We are still, we've approved everything that's in the queue and we're working on a few sidewalk approvals.
Great.
So the only thing I know of is that we might hear from in the near future is Starbucks, but they haven't presented anything formal yet.
Good, good. And we've already done Ann's pictures. Hopefully most of you are on the 2 o'clock call. The only other thing that I brought up at our last meeting last Wednesday was prizes for those using, Eric.
Yes, just before we get into that, I did have one request that just came in within the last hour about that handicap parking space on Congress Street, where we removed it Monday to put in a 15-minute parking space for Bennett's. Well, now we've got a complaint that they missed the handicap spot. So they put the handicap spot over across the street. That last one closes the Fleet Street.
Why doesn't staff review that request? We'll come back to you guys with a follow-up.
Great. Great. So does anybody else have something before we start talking about?
Well, I guess while we're talking about handicapped spaces, it's back to the spaces that we've lost from the Whale lot and Bridge Street lot. Is there anywhere to put them, or are we just losing them?
And you know, we relocated the from the Whale lot. I don't believe we had a net loss on those. We relocated those.
Okay. I was trying to figure it out walking around, and honestly, it was so hot that
And then on Bridge Street, we created one across the street, next to the holistic, the doctor's, it's a acupuncture's massage.
On
Bridge Street.
On Bridge Street.
Yes.
Okay, cool.
And then I'm going to reach out to Discover Center. I've got a note. I got to call Robin and discuss. So what we were planning on that one was, she has seven or eight spaces in her parking area, and currently her staff is using those spaces. So in lieu of having her staff use them, we were talking about maybe creating handicap spaces for herself, and then
I mean, they're the most vocal ones. If you could make something
right.
That's a solution for them,
right?
Then
and
I think you have a
solution. The solution would be, we would give them parking passes at the Foundry Garage. So her staff would be able to relocate, and then the better utilization for clientele that are handicapped.
I think that's a good solution.
Yeah, I mean, we understand that, you know, there's no perfect here, but, you know, we believe we're working in the right direction.
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Martha, you had a question?
My question is, what are we doing to promote the use of the Foundry Garage as a way for people who are used to parking in the Bridge Street lot or for other losses downtown? I think this is a key time so that we can change people's habits about where they're going to park and have them, you know, experience the Foundry parking garage and be more positive going towards the fall.
Well, we have a 4 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock meeting, whatever time the next meeting is, with the Bridge Street pop-up group. And we were proposing to link their site to our Foundry Place site so that when people are looking at for that pop-up New Hampshire, it has, you know, where do you park? It links right to the Foundry Place and has that. So our parking director, Ben Fletcher, is excited about that. There are signs that point to the Foundry Garage as well, but, you know, it's something that's an ongoing challenge. We have recently painted the sidewalk in front of the plumbing supply store, electric supply store, Ferguson's. So it is a much more
obvious.
Yeah, obvious. Thank you. Obvious means of walking. So that the sidewalks through there have improved, and I think those things are going to go a long way. And I think once people are looking, they're going to quickly drive over that way. So
just to follow up on that, I'm concerned about people who are driving into the city, and somehow doing more to direct them into the Foundry Garage. If you've been used to parking downtown, please consider the Foundry Garage as your best alternative. Somehow just because I think it's those people who don't know where to go. And even though we have sort of basic directions to the Foundry Garage, I think we do need to do more to have some more positive promotion.
Sure, we'll look at more wayfinding. It's something that we've been working on with Juliet in that group. So,
thanks,
Peter.
Yes.
Hi, John Gollum. Sorry, I had trouble connecting.
Hi, John.
I had a couple of people reach out to me, and I'm just throwing this out. I don't know what the solution is with the barbershop down there, that they're trying to figure out. You know, they have a clientele that's older and that they won't walk to the Foundry Garage, so they're having customers cancel their appointments. I didn't know that. I know they have a couple of places in front of their shop there, but it seems like a lot of the spaces now are taken up. So they just wanted me to convey to you to see if there's anything you guys could think about doing. So that's why I'm just raising that question.
Sure. And we've heard that feedback a number of times. So it's something that, I mean, there is the Foundry Garage right there. It's equidistant from the Bridge Street lot that, you know, is currently occupied, and there are on-street spaces. So we understand that there's concern for that. You know, we believe that there are options at the moment. There's no simple solution for that at this point.
Okay.
Thank you. I didn't know if you were aware of it. I just wanted to raise the
issue. No, we're very.
Thank you, Peter.
Yep.
Thank you.
Anybody else have any thoughts? If they want to get out?
Is it okay if I speak? To Martha Fuller Clark's point.
Sure.
So recently, somebody from the Air Force Base posted, you know, I'd like to walk in and just have a dinner somewhere. Is there a place I can go without reservations? And I suggested that they park at the Foundry Garage, walk past Dwyer's Pub and Bridge Street Bistro, cross the street, go down Vaughan Mall, and then down the street towards Market Square, and they'll pass dozens of restaurants that have outdoor seating. So independently, I was going to make a video of that, a walkthrough, but it might be better if it came from you guys in the city, some sort of map that shows all the different places that have the outdoor seating now.
I'm not sure. Are they requiring reservations at most places? No.
Most places you can walk and sit down.
Okay.
Correct.
We already have a map like that we created on our website, so we could make sure it's updated. I can work with Stephanie. But the problem we have with doing that is that we're worried that we'd miss a restaurant, and the city was the one responsible for not listing a restaurant. That's, you know, so it's a little bit problematic for the city to be the one doing that, and we've been a little nervous about that. So,
Julian, maybe I can work with you on that, because we have maps on our website, and maybe we can work something.
Yes, you do.
Okay.
I think the pop-up is just going to make that garage fill up organically. The garage is suddenly in the center of the world, and it wasn't before.
So we also used to have the digital sign out here when you get off the highway, Juliet and Peter, I think, and it said Foundry Place Garage.
It's still there. It's just a formal sign versus a large informal sign. So it is there.
I don't come that way, so thank you.
Great. So
I would just mention too that we've reached out to the GSA to see if we could extend the parking hours at the McIntyre building. Currently it's only on weekends, after six on Friday and Saturday and Sunday. And John Gollum's request, we've reached out to the GSA. So we're waiting to see if we could extend that to evenings during the week.
Thank you, Nancy.
That'll be terrific.
That's outstanding.
Everybody should cross their fingers really hard, though.
Good. So any thoughts about giving prizes out to those who do the best job decorating their streetscape or their sidewalkscape?
I think it's a great idea.
I could just weigh in. The city staff did have a chance to talk about this and internally a little bit. Karen is not here today, so I told her I'd report back with Nancy Kramer's help and Stephanie's too. I guess the only concern that we would have is that everybody is sort of has varying degrees of resources available. So maybe thinking about something that's not necessarily a prize per se, but maybe an acknowledgement, and this may be what we were thinking of already, but sort of an acknowledgement of all the creativity that's happening out there. You know, I think Anne's slideshow was so awesome because it showed how each different location with a whole variety of resources, range of resources, is still putting their character or their mark on that space. And what was really nice was to be able to see it from the street, from the sidewalk side and not from the street side. Because when you look at it from the sidewalk side, you realize these spaces have been decorated in a really inviting way. And I think showing that versus showing the side where the drivers are seeing sometimes is really nice. So I think we were inclined to just say, I think it's great. Self-promotion, case studies of all the creative thing that's happening out there. And if there's this subcommittee could somehow figure out a way to promote that. And if you want to pick categories or something like that, but just try to be careful about, you know, recognizing that not everybody's a Massimo versus, you know, there might be more like a Dwyer's Pub. So I was
thinking, what if we had a raffle for the professional group to do a makeover? Somebody comes in and the professional group comes in and they supply the materials and resources and you know, help spruce up somebody.
Cool idea.
Our concern is that a lot of the folks that don't have the resources to do it or the wherewithal to do it are on the hairy edge.
Yeah.
And, you know, just somebody else providing that resource to them might be a nice way of boosting them.
I think these people just don't even have manpower to do things.
Yeah, right. Right. Also true.
Right.
When I look what I'm taking off of Evan Mallett's plate right now, he would no way be where he is with outdoor dining if Bob White and I hadn't stepped in. He simply has no bandwidth for it.
Right.
Knowing we have the newsletter on Mondays and Thursdays, there's not tons of restaurants. Could we each newsletter just feature one and write a little story about what they're doing and how it came about or some little engaging thing?
Yeah, I've been doing that.
I volunteer to help with Stephanie. I'm not trying to stick you with it.
No, I actually have been doing that. And so send me the pictures you have, Anne, and I'll do more of it.
I'll actually send you the stories to go with, because that's really interesting.
We don't have a huge amount of space because people tell us they don't read it. But the Citizen Response Task Force webpage on the city website has a whole montage of all the pictures. So
love that.
And as you said in the last meeting, the more we all share that stuff on social media, the better.
Right.
I mean, the best thing we can do for restaurants and stores is promote them on social media because they don't have time.
If you can keep sending us the stuff, then obviously we're pushing it out on our social media channels as well. All Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, we're posting it out there. So anything you can send would be helpful.
I think you get a lot of views, Valerie. I think you have a lot of viewership.
We do.
Yes.
You're a great place to push it out. I mean, my latest little story I thought was so wonderful is that those cool chairs that Elephantine Bakery has, John Acar says, "Where'd you get your chairs? I should have chairs like that for my expansion." And Elephantine said, "Well, we close at 2. Why don't you just use ours?" So every afternoon, the chairs move from Elephantine to Cava. I mean, I think that's
fantastic.
A lot of neighborliness happening out there.
Martha, you have a thought?
I'm concerned about having a contest and highlighting some restaurants against some other restaurants? And then are we driving patrons to a certain segment of the restaurants where we want everyone to do well? So I like the idea of getting the stories out. I'm not so sure I'm in favor of awarding prizes.
So the thought is that the prizes would come towards the end of the season, not when we're driving patrons. But now the other thought is that Peter saved so much money on that, on the barriers, that we just award everybody who does a street dining a certain amount of money.
That's a nice idea.
And they can use that to fluff pay up their insurance. Pay their insurance, right?
Right.
But what about the restaurants that aren't going to do that?
Well, you know, as James and I talked about at the very beginning, it's going to be hard to be fair to all. The goal is to be fair to Portsmouth and to enliven Portsmouth, not necessarily individuals, but to get the whole community back alive again.
I would caution against a direct payment to specific entities versus supporting with some sort of infrastructure improvement or some sort of thing that the city purchases to enhance the activities that are out there. I'm worried that by giving direct payments to somebody, we run into the, if there's a reimbursement from the CARES Act, we need to document it well. There could be challenges associated with just giving direct grants. I'm not saying we shouldn't explore whether that's a possibility, but I would caution that focusing on material support that would enables or allows for the activities to occur is something the city can readily do versus the direct payment, which could be problematic.
So how about some kind of program where we support the covering of the barriers? I think the biggest problem is those barriers. You go down the street, you look inside them, people are doing a wonderful job. The problem is the barriers themselves aren't inviting. So there's one thought, Valerie.
So thank you, Mark. That was actually going to be my recommendation. That is an across-the-board fair thing to do. The thing that we're hearing from people is, Massimo has a lot of interior design genes in his body. Many other people do not. So making it fair and doing something that covers the concrete or the water barriers, I think, is a really good move. The other thing is that we need to be fair to all businesses, not just restaurants. So what about retailers? Many of the retailers are thinking about once Bridge Street starts opening up, there's going to be a lot of foot traffic. Then they might consider actually putting stuff out on the street, on the sidewalk. So maybe we're looking at tents, and I'm just throwing out that. Nobody has asked that question. Well, one person has, but has mentioned it. But if we offer tents to all retailers who want to be out on the street, so then it's across the board, across a couple of different industry segments, and it's fair for everybody.
Good.
I think we have to be really careful, though, and I think the city manager expressed real caution about, is this the appropriate use of city money in one particular section of downtown? And I'm speaking with my economic development hat on here. These businesses are really struggling. And we've worked really hard to get them additional revenue sources through these seats that are out there. I get really nervous about just changing the focus onto let's make everything just really beautiful when we really just need to make these businesses survive for the next, really through to March. I think the next phase is going to be the most difficult for these people when we do close the doors. And I know it's fun, and it's fun. It's really nice to see the vitality downtown, and that's what we really want to do. But when we start crossing into, like, let's make everything pretty and put pressure on these businesses to do that, or you know, barrier shame one over the other, I don't know what you call it, I get really nervous, because they are struggling. You know, we talked in our little group or in staff about maybe people round up their bill at the restaurant and it goes into a fund, and you know, and there's funding there. I'm just not sure how at large how appropriate it is for that. And I know that's not a popular thought, but I'm just concerned. So I'll leave it at that.
And I wanna just reiterate, follow up on what Nancy's saying, and Peter too. I think, you know, we as discussed at the task force meeting, there's still a whole season ahead of us where we mm-hmm. are gonna be transitioning indoors. And the more we can do without using a lot of city funds right now, necessarily, the more we can save those city funds for something that we might anticipate that we don't even know is a need yet. There are other potential available funds too that we'd like to look into using. And I think just having some idea that this is not just a few month phase, that we're gonna be looking at wanting to support these businesses over a longer term, that those priorities may be yet to emerge. So I think that's where we're a little bit tentative about spending city funds on just one purpose right now.
Good point. James.
Yeah, this is, we're I may be diverging even more in that direction of the next season, but since it's been brought up, this is my pitch to this group. The street closure seems to be winding down. So I'm wondering if this group could wind up on the, you know, September, October, November, December issue. It might not apply to Eric, parking and transportation, but I think it applies to probably everybody else on this call. Is that task that we're talking about. We're gonna need a committee that's working on that next phase. How do we support businesses and the community through the fall and winter?
Stephanie.
I actually had a conversation yesterday with Monty at the Music Hall wearing my Strawberry Bank hat. We have been the anchors of Vintage Christmas in Portsmouth. We've developed a national reputation for that event. That is gonna be very different this year. Whether either of us have actual live anchor events is very much in question. And I would have to wonder if the holiday parade seems a little, certainly the crowds on the street will not be a good idea. So perhaps we can reimagine Vintage Christmas in Portsmouth as a way to encourage holiday shopping sales for our retailers, but anything else that we can do that maintains our reputation as a great holiday place without being shoulder to shoulder.
Martha.
It struck me that the Tuscan site that's at the end of Lafayette Road is closed and empty. It's very large. Whether or not there's a way that we could negotiate to open that up for, a crafts fair but with following all of the guidelines, but there's a space where there's parking and there's huge empty space inside. It would be worth looking at something like that as a way to help drive retail.
Good. Anybody else?
So focusing on winter here, the question that I asked of Karen yesterday was about, and this is again, all businesses, not just restaurants, not just retail, all businesses, is something like UV lighting. I know that Kim is not excited about UV lighting, doesn't believe that's a good solution for us. But are there other things like that we're not aware of that will allow, that the city perhaps could provide a subsidy, so a match, if you will, if it's for air filtration. Because whether or not we have the ability to make it safe indoors, unless we can, unless that messaging gets out there, nobody's gonna go indoors. So if it's across the board, some sort of, and I don't know what that is, I'm not the health person, but is there something along the line of UV lighting that we can, that the city can help to subsidize or grant, not give the money to each business, but help to subsidize to allow people to go indoors and allow people to feel safe?
There are technologies that have been shown to be very effective with virus reduction in air. And UV is definitely a technology that's used. They do it in line in the air handling systems. Bipolar ionization, which if you remember the old smoke eaters in bars, does a good job. The city's currently doing retrofits to a number of their facilities to install some new systems for those reasons. You know, I would look to James. His area expertise is in this area. It's a matter of, the air changes per hour and neutralizing the viruses as they go through as you're air handling it. So, I mean, there's ways to reduce the potential exposure. You won't eliminate it, but you can help reduce it by number of air changes per hour. And that's an interesting thought, whether it's assistance with folks identifying simple retrofits to their air handling systems, and maybe we combine that with energy improvements. So that you're getting a double bang for what you're doing. If you're going and you're retrofitting something, you do it in any energy efficient manner. It's not necessarily mutually exclusive. Those are long-term structural type of changes. But I think, if we're looking at this for another year, it might be worth exploring those things. So I don't know, James, you could speak better to this stuff than I.
No, I think you said it well. I think the important thing is that there are improvements that can be made indoors, but they're going to reduce risk. There's no silver bullets. But I think the technical topic of how to improve indoor safety, I think that's an excellent topic for the health subcommittee to take up. And our office, because we design buildings and we design ventilation systems for buildings, our clients are looking to us for what their options are for reducing risk. So one thing what we can do is we can pass along, everybody's learning quickly, we can pass along what we've learned. And just like other information is being distributed by the health subcommittee, information about indoor health and risk reduction can be part of what they provide through the task force. So I will take that to the health committee.
And I continue to see in my office, in regards to healthcare and senior living communities, different ways to manage the airflow, different things you can do. And it's very much, this is James's thing, not mine, but if I knew where to forward it on to, and I think you're right, James, I think it's the health committee. As I see things, I know I've seen things about laminar flow and negative air pressure and ways to make the air move differently and away from people. So when I see that, send it to Ann, maybe? Copy, James?
Send it to Ann, and I'll let Ann know that we've tasked her committee with this topic. And I think they'll be ready for it, and they'll be ready to dive in.
Okay. They seem very scientific and very thorough. So I think they're people that would read it and understand it.
They are the science group.
They're the science group. Okay, cool.
So is everybody, I think everybody's in agreement that we should change our name to the Street / Winter Survival Committee?
Something like that.
Something along those lines.
The building,
sure.
The building streets, the building and streets. I don't know. Anne, come up with something quick.
I think we have to be, I think the health group is the right place for us, the indoor air quality and all that kind of stuff. I have to say, I'm not going to be able to provide a lot of guidance on that kind of stuff. Right. I think there will still be a need for street, activity. It just might shift to be more of a support for the indoor or previously indoor activity, activating the curbside pickup zones and still figuring out if there's any way to sustain that outdoor activity into the winter months. I mean, I brought this up with the building inspector, and I think there's definite challenges to that. But I think thinking about activating our streets long into the winter might be something we want to think about.
I mean, as I'm watching other communities, some towns, I'm watching a lot of towns in New Jersey, suburban New York City, because they're in the thick of it. And I'm seeing towns that are buying tenting that are logoed, says, City of Portsmouth on it, and they're putting it over the dining areas for the restaurants. The city is providing it. Tents are expensive, and tents don't hold snow either. But I've kind of grabbed some of those. This week it was, what are we doing here? But maybe next week I'll do a quick screen share of what's happening other places again.
That'd be great.
The Clipper Strong Group talked about tents and, using some of that fund, not so much for the kind of tents that you're talking about, and like they have at Robert's Grill in Kittery. Is that the kind you're thinking of?
In New York City too, and they were like double wide of those Easy Ups, but they were larger size. I think Easy Ups are 10 by 10. It looked like these were 10 by 20.
Yeah, the code. I talked to Pat Howe about this.
Yeah, how does that work?
And there's, it all depends. It can get very expensive, especially when there's requirements for flame retardation. And that drives the cost up by a huge magnitude. So they were looking at it not so much for the larger tents, but for like the pop-up ones, even during this season for rain or the beating sun that we've had, the last couple weeks. So we did look into that a little bit, and we can share that information.
Okay. David Dwyer put up tents. He's got the whole street tented.
Yeah, there's a square footage threshold, and I think staff would have had to look at that. Correct, Juliet? Yeah.
Yes.
I'm planning on giving him some business later today, so I'll find out. He's such a cute kid.
Yeah. Well, dang. I mean, I think that's the other thing, too, that I know maybe not through this committee, but that Economic Development Commission, talking about assistance in terms of marketing the city as a whole. We're open, we're safe. Mm-hmm. Get the message out of how safe we are, and to encourage people here. Sort of a PR campaign, but then also working with individual businesses that, and this gets more to the retail, online or e-commerce is going to be more important. There's so many ways, and we're looking to other cities and some models that have worked elsewhere. And if anything seems right for this committee, we'll bring it back.
Well, that's great.
James.
So, every fall is different. Sometimes we get, an Indian summer or whatever, or get a little bit of a break. So looking for ways to extend people being comfortable outdoors. One thing people do is they use the gas-fired heaters. And those are an environmental disaster. But we're not driving much, so maybe we could justify it that way. That might be a piece of equipment that the city could supply. They're probably expensive, but they would, if you have a combination of a fall where you don't have an early cold snap, combined with augmenting and making it comfortable outside with a heater or something that blocks the wind, that might extend things a little bit. One thing I noticed when I apparently had more free time was that you could be comfortable outside of Ceres Street Bakery eating your lunch very late because it faces south and it's got the heat from the street and from the brick wall behind you. And if it's not windy, you could be out there on a December day and have it be 35 degrees and be comfortable. That's a pretty unique circumstance that they have there.
Good. Anybody else? So we'll come to our committee meeting on Wednesday. On Friday, or do we want to have a meeting Friday, Juliet?
I will be on vacation on Friday.
Oh, well, then we all should go on vacation.
And I think Peter will too.
I'm going to go on vacation too.
So let's push to Monday.
I'm going to be gone all next week as well.
Yeah, I'm also gone on Monday, but if we have any applications for you guys, we'll make sure they get to you on Monday.
Great. And why don't we plan on continuing this winter fall discussion, even albeit it might be brief, on Monday.
Okay. Sounds good.
Mr. Chair, one more thing I just wanted to raise, Peter kind of alluded to this. We do think it would be helpful to have sort of a volunteer group of design professionals and maybe other expertise that businesses can at least ask questions of, or maybe get resource referrals to, from. The staff is limited in our time and also our expertise. We don't have design professionals on staff and things like that. So, if there is a way to support businesses through pro bono kind of assistance, I think it would be great if the task force could be the conduit through which that can happen. And I don't know how we start that ball rolling, whether it's just compiling a list of people who are willing to, give their advice, or maybe it's manual labor, who knows, but we thought that might be a helpful thing to do.
We have the design professionals group, but I think Andrew Bagley started some list, something like that. Andrew, are you actually paying attention to this call? There was some thought of a kind of a list of people who can help in a variety of places beyond the design professional.
Yeah, I have that list in my back pocket, just of citizens in town that have unique skill sets. So if there's a need arises, as I'm sure it will, we can get in touch with people quickly.
But definitely the design professionals group, because that was more than just architects and designers. That was a pretty crazy long list of writers and marketing people and economic development people and civil engineers and graphic designers. It was a really diverse group.
So if I can just share that on our website, you can search by designers or architects, or you can search all through all of those, and there'll be a list that will pop up. So that's another resource on PortsmouthCollaborative.org under the membership. So that's a pretty good list for all of those as well.
And do you want to be the conduit? Assuming you don't get over.
I think I already have been the conduit.
Yes, so do I. So
for the last 8 weeks.
That's my thought too. So
are you having fun?
It's, in my day job, things move so very slowly, and this has been very gratifying to do something that rockets along so fast. We say let's drop barriers, and 30 minutes later I'm downtown and there's barriers dropping. It's amazing.
Go Peter, go.
Go Peter, go. Normally I chase work, and 2 years later we win it, and 2 years after that the shovels are in the ground. You know how that goes. So
good.
Yeah, so Julia, you have a pretty good conduit.
It can be brought to this committee, or it can go directly to Ann, I think.
Yeah, and we will we'll definitely keep in mind Valerie's list too, if people ask about professional, who they can go to for professional assistance. Right. I think we're just looking for some people who might have some volunteer hours they're willing to give.
Yeah.
And I think my group, I mean, really, it's only a couple of us that hung in there after that first week. Everybody else is ready to jump right in. I have a few architects who were so disappointed that they didn't get to participate because it went
right.
I mean, I have people that are ready to, you know, raise their hand and say, let me help. So yeah, ask away.
Great, that's exciting. Okay, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I'll second.
All in favor? Thank you all very much. This was a very productive discussion.
Agreed. See you all on Monday.
Thanks.
Bye-bye. Except for you guys.